22 and 27 kilometers where the bulk of the ozone is. You also can see, just as in the tutorial slides, temperatures decrease until you get to the tropopause, where ozone and temperature start to increase. It's a nice plot. Then we had radio issues. So this was the evening launch on Monday night. And I can go back and forth between these. That's the earlier one. That's the later one. So what do you see going on there? Tell me some things you're seeing as I flip between those two. The boundary layer height, what do you see going on with the boundary layer height? That's a pretty clear boundary layer right there at about 5 kilometers. Not as clear there. Temperature inversion is a little weaker, maybe a little higher. What's going on down at the surface? You get higher temperature. You got a strong gradient in ozone right at the surface.
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting. That wasn't there in the afternoon profile. We're going to look at this more closely when we get to the mixing ratio. What about upper atmosphere? What happened to the ozone layer? It's hard to tell because we're missing so much data up there, but as I go back and forth between the two, is it at the, roughly the same altitude as it was before?
Yeah. A little higher.
The ozone concentrations look a little higher. That makes me suspicious of the data because I don't expect it to change too much, but we'll take a look. But I'm looking at that gradient there at about 18 kilometers where ozone starts going up. Looks almost on the same trajectory in both of those, right?
Mm-hmm.
You're missing some dots, but they look about the same. The data doesn't change very much. Temperatures changed a little bit. A little cooling in the upper troposphere, it looks like, in the evening profile. What is it warming? That's the afternoon. That's even warming. Let's go on to the next one. Oops, go back. There's the next one. Oh, no, the communication's even worse. This is the dawn launch yesterday morning. Oh, that's hard. But let's look at the bottom where we can see things. I guess we'll look at that more closely in a minute. That's the evening, that's the morning. Really hard to tell what's going on at the tropopause because we're missing so much data. Let's go to the next one. That's yesterday noon. Had a big data loss there in the middle of the troposphere. Lots of changes there between morning and afternoon, huh? The dust storm was kicking up, right? The winds were picking up from morning to afternoon. What happened to ozone? Looks like it increased at the surface. What about aloft? A little hard to tell. So that's the dawn one, and you see that elevated ozone at about 4 or 5 kilometers. That's the afternoon one. Now that elevated ozone maybe got lifted up a little higher. You don't see it until you get above five kilometers. You get a little hitch down at the surface. Looks like the boundary layer is still about 4 or 5 kilometers thick. There's the dawn one from this morning. So that's yesterday afternoon. That's this morning. Then let's go to this afternoon. Afternoon, morning. Afternoon, morning. Boundary layer. Temperature hitch didn't look like it moved, did it?
Mm.
Is it like 2.5 kilometers? Right where the peak of ozone. So we got this interesting peak of ozone sitting at about 3 kilometers. We're going to zoom in on that in a minute. Let's go back, if I can flip back, keep that in your head. That's our last profile. Look where the stratospheric ozone is. It's just under 16 millipascals, peaking between 21 and 27 kilometers. just under 16, maybe a little bit lower near, peaking between 21 and 26 kilometers. So the ozone layer didn't change. Stratosphere looks pretty similar. And we'll go validate the stratosphere bit. Stratosphere dynamics is simple. The consistency is over larger geographic scales. In the troposphere, things can change over a few kilometers. And so things in the troposphere happen on a different geographic and temporal scale than the stratosphere. That's important to know. Let's zoom in and now look at the troposphere portion, just the first 15 kilometers. So there's our first
profile. Sorry that green is really painful to look at. that's the relative humidity. It's actually twice the relative humidity. So 200 would be 100% relative humidity. That would be a cloud. You see that the relative humidity peaks right at the layer, the altitude where the potential temperature starts to increase and where the ozone starts to increase. I think I mentioned yesterday, I suspect that that really dry air and a little increase in ozone, this is ozone transported from somewhere else. That may be influencing what's going on here. But notice our ozone on the first day was 45 ppb in the boundary layer, which extended up to 4 kilometers. What else do you notice about ozone in this plot? What's of interest or note?
You were talking about yesterday, just the gradient that it has.
Yeah, there's a steady positive gradient from about 7 kilometers all the way up to 12 or 13. Keep an eye on that as we move forward. Anything else of note?
There's a lot of variation within that gradient too.
There's a lot of zigging and zagging in there, and that is, the troposphere has lots of little filaments and fingers and mixed layers in it. Think about making a cake and then mixing it and dripping in some chocolate syrup into the batter. Watching the filaments of chocolate get wrapped around and mixed around. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. That happens in the atmosphere too. It's a fluid. The air is a fluid. And it's got filaments and fingers and chocolate syrup mixing in it.
What effect will aerosol layers have on tropospheric ozone?
The aerosol layers, certainly
not even
change.
To the extent of the dust storm we had yesterday, but
yeah.
You know, we do get elevated aerosol layers of different kinds here.
So my first inclination is that the aerosols are going to change the radiative properties of the atmosphere, which will impact production rates. I don't know about the surface reactions that ozone may have. I guess it depends on the presence of hydrocarbons and NOx and sunlight. So if any of those change, and I would guess in the aerosols, some of the it depends on what the aerosols are of. I mean, if it's sand and dust, I think it's mainly a radiative effect. That's my inclination.
If there was not visible to the eye, if there was an elevated smoke layer, then I would assume that would have an effect.
Smoke will definitely have an effect. And I'll show you a stark example of that tomorrow when I talk about the greatest hits from this project in Houston. If you get biomass burning smoke into your air shed, that contains hydrocarbons, which then react with local emissions, NOx emissions, and you can generate a lot of ozone.
Yeah, the surface areas, it depends on the size.
Yeah.
So you have to look at surface area, total surface area. There's a lot of little particles. It'd be different than dust particles, which have a small number. So the area size, the total area that interact go that way down with the dust. Mm-hmm. That's my guess.
Now, also the winds. The winds are moving air pretty quickly, and so you can't get a buildup of, if you have a local strong NOx source, in the high wind environment, it's gonna get blown and the concentrations are gonna be low. So I guess the combination of, what generates all that dust is high winds, and the high winds are probably holding ozone down. Take a look at what happens to the data here. New environment for me to kind of look at.
In this area, it's not a...